Hello, how are you?
Yes, good afternoon, good afternoon. So my wife is audible. Please let me know my wife is audible to all of you.
Yeah, not audible. So yes, my wife is audible to all of you. Please let me know.
Good afternoon to all. My voice is audible to all of you. Please let me know. Are you able to listen to me properly? So today is the last day of this lecture series, and today we have to cover this topic which we have. Let me show you the syllabus. So we have completed basic principles of MBBT. Cell culture techniques, we have discussed the techniques which are there: recombinant technology, protein technology, protein quantification, separation, purification, electrophoresis, blotting is also completed, flow cytometry is completed. Now we are left with only two parts. The number one is bioinformatics and number two is microscopy. Otherwise all the other things are completed. Okay. So now we have to start our today's lecture series. So I am just waiting for few more students to join, then we will start the class. Okay. Getting my point? So are you getting me? My voice is audible to all of you. Please let me know. Are you able to listen to me properly now? So that I will start the today's lecture. I have to start microscopy today. I have to start buying something. So we have to start with our remaining topic which is there. We have to complete microscopy today as well as bioinformatics. So these are the two topics which are left, otherwise all of the other topics are completed. So this is our last lecture series together. This is the last YouTube live session of this lecture series. Otherwise we will remain connected to Telegraph also, and we will remain in touch with each other. But till now, this is all for this lecture series, and we will remain in touch with the group also, and I will answer to your all queries in the mail also. Plus for it you have to be patient little bit, so that I will have a time that definitely I will reply to all the queries which you all have. Okay, but today is our last YouTube live session for this lecture series, and after which you have your exams also. You will be free for your exams as well as you can focused on. You must be focused on your review paper also. So are you getting me now? Everything is fine now. Please let me know. So very good afternoon to all of you, and thank you all for your support. Thank you all, you are here along with me on this afternoon timing. I know you must have your busy schedule also. I know you have some your own schedule, but still you are here along with me, and that means a lot to me also. And I want to thank all of you for this whole lecture series, the whole day which we have together. So now, without wasting much time, I will continue with the remaining part which is there. No, I will not conduct any exam, but yes, your assignments are there with me. So only according to these assignments which you submitted me, we will have the criteria, okay? So don't worry regarding the exams, because you have your own final exams. So that is why I am not focusing on your conducting any exam on this MBBT lecture series. Your assignments are there with me. That is the only criteria. So I think that's all for now. We have to start our session. I am going to start microscopy today, and after it we have another topic which is bioinformatics, and after it all the sessions, all the lectures will be completed, okay? So now I am just going to start with microscopy. So shall we start now? Please let me know. Okay, so now we are just continuing with the today's session, which is on microscopy. Yes, so it's animal cell culture. So we have to start microscopy today. Microscopy is a very simple instrument which is there in our normal lab. Even you have seen these microscopes from your from plus 1 plus 2 onwards, so you must aware of it. So I am now going to start with the topic which is microscopy. After it we have another topic which is bioinformatics. So we will try to complete these two topics together, and then our lecture series, the topics in our lecture series will be completed. And if anything is left, if any topic or PPT is not given to you, is not provided to you, you can let me know. I will provide everything to all of you. Okay. So now I'm just going to share microscopy. Microscopy, as the name implies, so microscopy is basically an instrument of for viewing objects that are too small to be seen by the naked eyes. So basically it is an instrument to see those objects which are very small, which we are unable to see by the naked eyes. That is known as microscope. So it is an instrument only. Microscopy is the science of investigating small objects. Using such an instrument is called microscopy. So now the history of it. In 1519 we have a scientist whose name is Janssen, who was the first who developed the microscope. In 1609, we have another scientist whose name is Galileo, who introduced compound microscope. And in 1620, we have another scientist, Hugi Jens, who developed a simple two-lens ocular system that was chromatically corrective. So these are the scientists. We have Louis Hoch, we have Robert Hooke. Robert Hooke was the one who discovered the cell. So this is a microscope, which is an optical instrument that uses a lens or a combination of lens to produce a magnified image. So you all are aware of it only. So if you are able to see, this is the place where we have to put our specimen. These are the lenses which are known as objective lenses. These are the lenses which are known as ocular lenses or eye lenses. From these lenses we have to see the object basically. So there is one more lens, or you can say condenser. It will condense the whole light. So microscope is an optical instrument that uses a lens or a combination of lens to produce a magnified image of an object too small to be seen by the naked eye. So microscope is basically is an instrument basically in which we have lenses, in which we have a combination of lenses to produce a magnified image that is too small to be seen with the naked eye. So microscope is basically what? It is a combination of lenses. We have ocular lenses, we have objective lenses, we have condenser. So all these lenses are here to magnify an image. So this is the simple, you can see, diagram of a microscope. We have eye lenses, we have condenser, we have objective lenses. So these are the objective lenses. We have some adjustment also. This is the light button, and there comes the light. So these are the main parts and the functions of these are the main parts of the microscope. The number one is eyepiece. Now what is eyepiece? To observe the specimen and enlarge the image, we have the objective lens. So we have one lens which is known as objective lens. These observe the specimen because they are placed very close to the specimen. So these objective lens, they will observe the specimen and enlarge the image formed by the objective lens. So objective lens is to focus and enlarge the specimen. They are placed close to the specimen. Adjustment knobs, to raise or lower the lens tube for focusing. Two big knob, the big knob is coarse adjustment, and the small knob is for the line adjustment. So we have adjustment knobs also. Then stage is to support the microscope slide. So this is the place where we have to put the slide only, or where we have to put the specimen. After it, we have clips to keep the microscope slide in position. Then we have diaphragm. What is the purpose of it? To control the amount of light which are entering through the objective lens. So this is the light, and we have a diaphragm also which will control the amount of light. Mirror is there to reflect the light into the objective lens. Condenser is here. Yes, this is condenser. Condenser to focus the light on the specimen. So there is a condenser which will focus the whole light on the specimen only. Getting my point? So the whole light will focus on the specimen only. Lens tube is here to hold the lenses which magnify the specimen. Base is here to support the microscope in a stable position. Limb is here for holding and taking the microscope. So these all are the basic parts of a microscope. So are you getting me properly? Are you getting me? My voice is audible? My voice is audible to all of you? Please let me know my voice is audible to all of you. Okay, thank you Pritam, thanks a lot. So let me continue then. So these are the parts of a microscope. So we have all these parts. We have eyepiece, objective lens, we have knob, diaphragm, condenser, lens tube. All these are the main parts of a simple microscope. After this, we have variables used in microscopy. So we have some terms which are there. The number one term is magnification. Now, what is magnification basically? Magnification is a degree of enlargement. How you are able to magnify the particular specimen. It's a degree of enlargement. So number of times the length, breadth and diameter of an object is multiplied. So basically what happened? We have to magnify or enlarge the specimens only. So it depends upon optical length, focal length and magnifying power of the earpiece.
Now the earpiece eyepiece. So it depends upon the optical length, focal length and magnifying power of the eyepiece.
Now what is total magnification?
The total magnification will be magnification of the eyepiece into magnification of the objective. So how much magnification is provided by the objective lens and how much magnification is provided by the eyepiece lens, both of these make the total magnification. Now we have another term which is known as resolution. Now what is it? It is the ability to reveal closely adjacent structural details as separate and distinct. We have limit of resolution, the minimum distance between two visible bodies at which they can be seen as separate and not in contact with each other. So limit of resolution is basically what? The minimum distance. It is a minimum distance between two visible bodies at which they can be seen as separate. So they can be seen as separate and they are not in contact with each other. That is known as limit of resolution. Then we have numerical aperture. It is the ratio of diameter of lens to its focal length. It's the ratio of diameter of the lens to its focal length. So capacity of an objective to render outline of the image of an object clear and distinct. Basically what we want that the image should be clear as well as it should be distinct. There should not be merging of the image. Now this is working distance. Distance between the front surface of the cap of the lens and the surface of the cover glass. So here we have the specimen. So it is a distance. So this is the distance between the front surface of the lens and the surface of the cover glass. So this is the working distance which is there between the objective lens as well as between the slide where we have the specimen. Now another term which is there in microscopy is contrast. What is contrast basically? It is differences in the intensity between two objects or between an object and the background. So it is basically the difference in the intensity. Like if you are able to see, the background color is light, this is darker in color. So contrast is basically between two objects or between one object and the background. So it is basically the intensity between the two objects. So these are the properties of the microscope objectives. We have magnification, numerical aperture, focal length, working distance, resolving power. So all these are the important properties of the microscope. So when you have to compare the microscope, you have to think of these points only. You have to think of magnification, you have to think of numerical aperture, focal length, resolving power. All these points should be keep in mind. So we have scanning, we have low power, we have high power, we have immersion. So we have different types of objective lens. Okay, so we have 4x lens, 10x lens, 40x and 100x. So we have three types of objective lens. We have 10x, 45x and 100x. So this is the magnification. That is the image get 10 times magnified. Then we have numerical aperture. Focal length is there. So we have to compare everything. Now after we have reflection. What is reflection? If the light enters the glass at any angle other than the right angle, a deviation in the direction will occur in addition to retardation. This is known as reflection. So if the light enters the glass at any angle other than the right angle, a deviation in the direction occurs in addition to retardation. This is known as refraction. So a curved lens will agree with both refraction as well as retardation. The extension of which is determined by the angle of incidence, refractive index and curvature of the lens. So this is refraction now. Now we have some another term used of diffraction. Diffraction is the change in the direction and the intensity of a group of waves after passing by an obstacle or through an aperture. So whose size is approximately the same as the wavelength of the wave? Dispersion is a phenomena in which separation of light into its constituents, wavelength occurs from entering a transparent medium. For example, white light consists of more than one wavelength. They should be separated or they would distribute when they pass through the prism or certain other medium. Magnification. Magnification is the process of enlarging an object only in appearance and not on in physical size. So magnification is the enlargement of the object. Please keep this thing in mind. It is the enlargement of the object only in appearance but not in physical size. Interference. Interference is the variation of wave amplitude that occurs when the waves of the same or different frequency come together. There could be constructive interference or there would be a destructive interference. So this is interference. After we have resolving power. Resolving power is defined as the distance separating two point objects within the specimen that can just be distinguished from one another in the image. So resolving power is defined as the distance. Resolving power is defined as the distance separating two point objects within the specimen that can just be distinguished from one another in the image. So these are the terms which are used in the microscopy basically. So this is the image formation by the converging lens. So this is the object if you are able to see. This is the object and by passing through the lenses we will get the image. So which the eye will see. So this is the object. This object will be magnified. If you are able to see, this object will get magnified. Now there are some aberrations also. What are aberrations? Aberrations are when lenses fail to bring rays or all rays on the given point on the object to a unique focus. This is called aberrations. Now, when there is an aberration, then blurred or not so clear images are formed. So when aberrations are there, the images will not be clear. This is because all rays are not focused at the same point and we do not get sharp images. There are two main types of aberrations. These are known as chromatic aberration or spherical aberration. So we have two types of aberration, the chromatic as well as spherical. What happens in these aberrations? We are able to get blurred or not so clear images are found. So this is because our rays are not focused at the same point and we do not get sharp image. So number one is chromatic aberration. So light is composed of spectrum of colors, each having a different wavelength, will be reflected to different extent, with blue being brought to the short focus than red. So this lens defect is known as chromatic aberration and results in an unsharp image or distorted image. So this is known as chromatic aberration and its correction is known as achromatism. So this is an aberration when the light is not focused properly. So it is possible to construct compound lenses of different glass elements to correct these. And achromat is corrected for two colors, red and blue, producing a spongy spectrum of yellow and green, which is in turn corrected by adding more lens components like fluorospar. Three colors can be brought into focus, the more expensive apochromat. Then we have spherical aberration. What happens in spherical aberration? Spherical aberration is caused by the withdrawal of its curvature, where the light rays entering through the lens at the periphery are refracted more than the light rays entering at the center of the lens, and thus not brought to a common focus. So these defects are also corrected by using a combination of lens elements of different class and of different shapes. So this is the spherical aberration. We are able to get blur image here, but by using chromatic aberration, again we are not able to find the correct image. So this is a convex lens. It is a convex lens used in a very simple microscope. A light ray parallel to the optical axis of the lens passes through the focus of the lens. So this is the object, and we will magnify it. If you are able to see, this small object will be magnified that much. So a light ray parallel to the optical axis of the lens passes through the focus of the lens, while a ray passing through the center of the lens does not bend. So a light ray parallel to the optical axis of the lens passing through the focus of the lens, while a ray passing through the center of the lens does not bend. So this object will magnify that much. So we have two rays. One ray will pass from the center, and another ray, one ray will pass through the center, and another ray will parallel to the optical lens. It will pass and then focus the lens on the magnified image. Now these are the key parts of the microscope. The objective has several major functions. The objective must gather the light coming from each of the various parts of the specimen. So this is basically the lens. This is the point source in object. This is the entry point. So the objective must have the capacity to reconstitute the light coming from various points of the specimen into various corresponding points in the image. The objective must be constructed so that it will be focused close enough to the specimen so that it will be projected magnified real image into the body to view. Now the types of microscopes which we have and its uses. The very simple are the light microscope, which includes bright field microscope, dark field microscope, phase contrast and fluorescence microscope. And in electron, we have two types of microscope: transmission electron microscope and the scanning electron microscope. So this is your homework also. You have to tell me the types of microscope along with their some features. That means we have bright field, dark field, phase contrast, fluorescence, transmission and scanning. So you have to let us know me about all these microscopes along with their characteristic features. So in light microscope, we will use the sunlight or we will use the artificial light. So in the bright field microscope, the very first is bright field. So this is a dark image against a brighter background. So if you will be able to see here, in bright field, the image will be brighter. That means the background, the image will be brighter than the image will be darker than the brighter background. The background will be brighter and the image will be dark. It has several objective lens. Two types are there, simple and compound. So simple containing single magnifying lens, and compound series of lens for the magnification. Light passing through the specimen into the objective lens. Oil immersion lens increase the resolution. Have one or two ocular lenses. The resolution is 200 nanometer here. So in case of compound, we have series of lenses. We have objective lenses, we have eye or ocular lenses. Even we can use oil immersion to increase the resolution. So this is an effective immersion of oil. So when we are using oil, what will happen now? If you are able to see, this is a specimen and this is a light ray which will pass, and from this lens we will see the image. This is the objective lens. But in case of oil immersion, we have to add the drop of the oil above the specimen, that is above the first loop, and then the magnification will be more. The image point, the magnification will be more here. Instead of here, the magnification will be more with the reverse immersion oil. So this is a light. The lower is the condenser lens. Then we have objective lens. Then we have the ocular lens. So this is a specimen. So we will be able to just get the final image. So the image is very small here, but the final image is magnified. This is small image and this is the magnified image, or you can say final image. So this is the, with the help of condenser lens, objective lens as well as the ocular lens.
You know what is the advantage of using these cells or using these microscope, which is the bright field microscope or simple or compound microscope. So these are used to view live or stained cells. That means sometimes we give some color to the cells or to the specimen. So these are used to view live or stained cells. Simple setup with very little preparation is required. Now, what are the disadvantages? Biological specimens are often of low contrast and needs to be stained. Okay, so biological specimens are sometimes of low contrast. So that means staining is needed. We have to give some color to the specimen. Staining may destroy or introduce artifacts. Sometimes what happens? Staining destroys the whole inner structure of the specimen. Resolution is limited to 200 nanometer only. So in case of this bright field microscope, the resolution is limited to 200 nanometer only. Then this is image formed by the bright field microscopy. We have gram positive cocci, we have gram negative cocci, bacilli or bacteria. So if you are able to see, the color is because of the staining only. So this is the bright field microscope. This is the very simple microscope, which is the bright field microscope. So the image is dark and the outside or the background will be bright in color. So that is why we have to use the staining to give the color to the specimen. Then after that, we have dark field microscopy. What is dark field microscopy? It produces a bright image of the object against a dark background. So it is the reverse of bright field. In the bright field, the image is dark and the background is bright. Here image is bright but the background is dark. So optical system to enhance the contrast of unstained bodies, specimen appears gleaming bright against the dark background. So here the background will be dark. So the dark background condenser high intensity lamp is there, funnel stop is there. This is the optics of bright field. If you are able to see, this is the place where we have to put the specimen. This is the place. These are the objective lenses and these are the condensers. You have to keep only one thing in mind, that in dark field the image is bright and the background is dark. So if you are able to see, here the background is dark and the image which we get, the results which we get, they are bright in color. So they are bright in color. So it is useful in demonstrating Tryponema, Leptospira, Campylobacter endospores. So they are useful in demonstrating certain specimens. Here the background is dark and the specimens are bright in color. Now what are the advantages? Simple setup, provide contrast to unstained tissue. So living cells can be viewed. So here we are able to view the living cells also. Disadvantage is that specimen needs to be strongly illuminated, which can damage delicate samples. So illumination or the shining of the specimen is quite needed. But during this illumination, sometimes what happens, the delicate specimen gets damaged. So this is bright field, dark field. Now we have another more, two important more microscopes. We have phase contrast microscope and we have fluorescent microscope. So these are very important microscopes. We have covered bright field now. So this is the bright field, this is a dark field. Now the name is phase contrast microscope. Now what is phase contrast microscope? It is very important technique or very important microscopy. It was discovered in 1934 by the Dutch scientist Wernicke. He produces high contrast image of transparent specimen. So here the specimens will be transparent, okay, and we will get high contrast images. So advantage is living cells can be examined in their natural state. So in phase contrast microscopy, basically we are able to examine living cells. This is the principle of phase contrast microscopy. It is an optical illumination technique in which small phase shifts in the light passing through a transparent specimen are converted into a contrast changes in the image. Light rays in the phase produce brighter image. Light rays out of the phase, they produce darker image. So we have two phases. In one phase we have brighter image and in another phase we will have the darker image. So contrast is due to the out of phase rays. So the contrast which will be there, it is because of the out of phase rays. So the out of phase form the darker image. So this is the diagrammatic representation. So this is a bacteria, suppose this is a specimen. So the rays will pass from this specimen. What will happen now? Rays deviated by specimen is 1/4 wavelength out of phase. So if you are able to see, the rays will get deviate. Okay, have to pass from this phase number plate 1. What will happen here? Here the ray will pass like that. This ray which is not passing through the specimen, it will pass like as such. But here, when the rays pass from the specimen, what will happen now? These rays will change their wavelength. So there is a change in the wavelength. And after the end also, when we will pass again here, deviated ray is half wavelength out of phase. What will happen now? Here the waves are above, here the waves are downward. So there is a change in the wavelength when it passes to the specimen. So there is a change in the wavelength. And then after it, we have to collect these deviated and undeviated rays. So this is undeviated ray which will pass as such. Okay, and this is deviated ray which will pass from the specimen. So and then we will have to collect both these rays. So this is annual diaphragm phase plate which is there in case of the phase plate. In case of phase contrast microscopy, we have the phase plate and we have the annual diaphragm. Let us check their functioning. We have condenser annulus also. So the condenser annulus or annual diaphragm is a opaque flat black plate with a transparent annular ring. It produces a hollow cone of light. Then we have phase plate. It is placed in back focal plane of objective. It enhances the phase difference by retarding diffractive wave front by 1/4 of wavelength. It reduces intensity of direct rays and equalizes it with the diffracted rays intensity. So this is the main, you know, this phase contrast microscope is here. In it we have basically phase plate. So this is the phase plate. In phase contrast microscopy, basically we have the phase plates. So this is the thing. We have condenser annulus, we have phase plates, we have specimen, we have condensers, and then we have objective lens also. And then these will pass through it and we will collect the deviated as well as undeviated rays. So this is the image of in case of phase contrast microscopy, what type of image we will get. Now what are the advantages of phase contrast microscopy? So phase contrast enables visualization of internal cellular components. We are able to visualize the internal cellular components, diagnosis of tumor cells, examination of growth, dynamics and behavior of a wide variety of living cells, ideal for studying and interpreting thin specimens. So disadvantage is this annular or ring limits the appearance to some extent which cause decrease in resolution, not ideal for thick specimens. So it is basically for the thin specimens only. So again, you have to see, we have the plates here. Now what will happen, if you are able to see, little difference in contrast is there in between cells and water. So if you are able to see, this is the condenser annulus, these are the condensers, this is the specimen. Now when the rays strike on the specimens, we will get two different types of color. One is light purple, another is dark purple. So provides very high contrast as compared to bright field and dark field. Image is generated from both diffracted and undiffracted light. So these we have light purple and dark purple color. One is undiffracted light, which will pass as such. So one is undiffracted light, which will pass as such, and another is diffracted light, which will have to pass through the phase plates basically. So it's useful for microbial mobility, shape of living cell, detection of endospores and inclusion body. So this is the basically phase contrast microscopy. So we have two types of rays. We have deviated rays and rays. So it converts the different degree of retardation of light rays passing through a translucent material into an amplitude differences to create an image contrast. So we will get the contrast in the images. We will get the light purple color as well as we will get the dark purple color because of these undiffracted and diffracted rays. So one is undiffracted, which will pass as such. If you are able to see, this dark purple will pass as such. So this dark purple will pass. These rays are undiffracted rays, and these rays, the light purple, they will pass through it. These are known as the diffractive rays. Now the applications. So objects with poor intensity can be resolved. Image of the unstained objects can be studied. So we are able to study even the unstained, like sometimes in many specimens have to be stained, but here we can able to watch or study the image, study the objects which are unstained. So it is widely used in microbiology and tissue culture research to detect bacteria, cellular organelles and other small entities in the living specimens. It allows the visualization of living unstained cells and their organelles. So we are able to welcome the living cells also. For the detection of bacterial components such as endospores and inclusion bodies containing polybeta hydroxybutyrate, polymetaphosphatase, sulfur and other substances, for that also we are able to use the phase contrast microscopy. Then after it we have fluorescence microscopy. Definitely in fluorescence we will have the, in case of fluorescence microscopy, what we will have? In case of fluorescence microscopy, we will have exposures. We have to expose the specimen to UV light, or you can say violet or blue light. Specimens are usually stained with fluorochromes. So here we have to use the fluorochromes in case of fluorescence microscopy. It shows a bright image of the object, resulting in the It shows a bright image of the object because of the fluorescent light emitted by the specimen. So we have to stain the specimen with fluorochromes. You will put it under the light, they will emit a, when you will put the specimen, they will emit a light only. Now what's the principle of fluorescence microscopy? So certain dyes called fluorochrome, after absorbing UV rays, raised to higher energy level. When the dye molecules return to their normal state, they release excess energy in the form of visible light. So we have to use the fluorochromes here, which will be absorb the light, and they will give us when we will use these dye molecules, they will release excess energy in the form of visible light. They will provide us the visible light only. So this is a specimen. This specimen, please keep this thing in mind, that this specimen is radioactively labeled and with fluorochrome. So when the light is passed through it, what we will get some brightly colored light also. So like here we will get the color. So use of fluoromicroscopy, we have Auramine, Rhodomine, which is yellow fluorescence, Tabaxilla, Then we have aquidine orange R, which can also be used as fluorochrome. We have QBC, we have aminofluorescence. So we can use any fluorochrome which will give the color to the specimen. So if you are able to see, this is aminofluorescence, this is the bacteria, and these are some antibodies. These specific fluorochromes attach. When we will able to watch this bacteria under the microscope, this type of image will be seen to all of us. So these are some fluorophores which we can use. We can use fluorosine isothiocyanate, we can use cyanine based dyes. So use extinctin fluorescent probes that can go inside the cell and bind to the intracellular molecules with high specificity. So this is the fluorescence in which we are able to get the color. So we have bright field microscopy in which we have to stain the cells, number one. We have dark field microscopy. In phase contrast, we will have deviated light as well as indivisible rays, so from which we will get the result, and in fluorescence we will get the colored result. Getting my point? Also, you have to let me know about all these microscopes with their specific feature, the point which is particularly only in that particular microscope. Okay, so this is your homework also. So this is the microscopy basically. These four microscopes are there, all four microscopy techniques are there: bright field microscopy, dark field microscopy, phase contrast and fluorescence microscopy. You have to tell me the important characteristic features of all these four microscopes, and two more are left now. So this is the another microscope which we have, which is known as, let me show you, electron microscopy. Now we have another. So we have two types of microscopy. We have done the simple microscopy, now we have the electron microscopy. In the electron microscopy, we have electron microscope. So this is a microscope. It was co-invented by Max Noll and Ruska in 1931. Electron microscopes use a beam of light, highly energetic electrons, to examine object on a very fine scale. So electron microscopy, obviously it is more beneficial as compared to the simple microscopy, and up to 2 million times, while best light microscope can give magnification up to 2000 times only. So we have four types of light microscopy and we have two types of electron microscopy. So this is the magnification in this microscopy is 2 million times much better as compared. So this is the electron microscopy is of two types, TEM and SEM. Now what is TEM? It is transmission electron microscope, and it is the stem of electron is formed here. What happens basically, stream of electron is formed in case of transmission electron microscope. Stream of electron is formed accelerated using a positive electrical potential, focused by metallic aperture and electromagnets. Interactions occur inside the irradiated sample, which are detected and transformed into an image. So we have interactions are there, which can be interactions occur there inside the sample, which are detected and transformed into an image. So basically, in this transmission electron microscope, we have stream of electron which is formed, accelerated using a positive electrical potential, focused by a metallic aperture and electromagnets. So this is your basically the projector lens forms image on fluorescent green screen. The magnification is that much as compared to simple light microscope. So here the magnification is very much high as compared to the simple light microscopy. So we have this light microscopy, we have this electron microscope. So in the light microscope, you should be able to see, this is a lamp, this is a condenser lens, this is a specimen. After it we have objective lens, then we have the eyepiece, and this is the final image only. But in case of this transmission electron microscope, we have the stream of electrons. That is my point. So we have the stream of electrons. So we have an electron gun. it will pass through the condenser lens. The specimen is here. Then after it we have the objective lens. After it we have the projector lens, and the final image will be fluorescent screen. So we will able to get the highly magnified final image with fluorescent screen. Getting my point? So in the light microscope we have only condenser lens, and we have objective lens, and the last is eye lens. But the image is here. But in case of this column, in case of this transmission electron microscope, we have electron gun, then condenser lens is there, specimen is there, objective lens is there. Look at the projector lens now, and the final image will be there with fluorescent screen. So this is the transmission electron microscope. So we have specimen here at the end. If you are able to see, look at how much magnified image is here. So the specimen is only that one in size. After final, we will get that much big specimen. So if you are able to see here, the specimen is very small, but at the end we will get a very enhanced or very magnified specimen. Getting my point? So this is the transmission electron microscope. We have the electron gun, we have condenser lens, we have the specimen, we have objective lens also, projector lens also, but the image will be very much enhanced. So final image on fluorescent screen, or final image on photographic film when screen is lifted aside. So this is known as the transmission electron microscope, where we will able to get the enhanced image with fluorescent screen. So this is the electron microscope. The another is, this is basically transmission electron microscope. The another type is scanning electron microscope. Now what happens in scanning electron microscope? Scan a gold-plated specimen surface of an object which is black and white, used to study surface features of cells and viruses. Scanning electron microscope has a resolution 1000 times better than the light microscope, but transmission electron microscope is resolution 10,000 times much better than the light. Scanning electron microscope, we have electron gun, we have magnetic lenses, there we have the specimen, there we have the specimen, and we will get the results in the monitor only. We will get the result in the monitor only. So this is the image which we will get with the help of SAM. So we have two types of transmission electron microscope, as well as we have scanning electron microscope. And this is your homework also, that you have to tell me the difference between scanning electron microscope and the transmission electron microscope. So you have to tell me the difference between scanning electron microscope as well as the transmission electron microscope. So this is the diagram of scanning electron microscope, and this is the difference between SAM and TEM. So you have to tell me the difference between SAM and TEM. Okay. Now this is again the features of electron microscopy, that from electron microscopy we are able to view regular cells, bacteria, mycoplasma, proteins. We are able to view all these cells with the help of electron microscopy. This is SAM and TEM. So in case of TEM, TEM form images using electrons, and in scanning utilize electrons that have bounced off the surface of the specimen. So in both it we are using the electrons, but that are transmitted through the specimen. Here what happens is light is passed through the specimen. The light is passed through the specimen in case of TEM. But in case of SAM, the light will be bounced back from the specimen. If you are able to get, the electrons will be bounced back from the specimen, and these electrons will be detected further. In case of transmission, it will pass only through the specimen. But here, it will bounce back from the specimen. So this is their main difference, that here the electrons that have bounced off the surface of the specimen, they are analyzed in case of scanning electron microscope. So this is the transmission electron microscope, which was first type of electron microscope to be developed, and is patterned exactly on the light transmission microscope, except that focus beam of electron is used instead of light. So transmission electron microscope is little bit similar as that of light microscope, but here what happens, instead of using the light, we are using the electrons. So electron is used instead of light to see through the specimen. Otherwise it is as same as the light microscope, but here only the one difference is that we are using electrons instead of light to see through the specimen. It was developed by Noll and Ruska in Germany in 1931. So it is same as we have simple light microscope, but the only difference is that here we are using the electrons, a beam of electrons to pass through the specimen. So this is the difference between simple microscope and electron microscope. We are using electrons. There is having a vacuum chamber. Electron magnets are present, and even the image is formed. So the image is formed as a photograph or as an image on a TV screen. So in the case of electron microscope, the results will be there in the TV screen only. In the monitor of the computer, the results will be there. But in case of simple microscopes, we will get the magnified image. We will able to see the magnified image by our own eyes. Now this is the difference between light microscope and electron microscope. Like focusing, bedding, everything is there. The difference between light and electron microscope. In electron microscope, the results will be in the computer only. But the magnification is quite high in case of transmission electron microscope. So this is a simple microscope which we have studied. We have specimen. We have specimen which will get enlarged. But another thing is, we have condenser lens, objective lens, projector lens, and this is the final image. But in case of TEM, we have electrons rather than light. We have electron as a source, and even we are using the electromagnetic lenses in case of electron microscope. Otherwise condenser lens is there, specimen is there, objective lens is there, everything is there, but instead of using the light as a source, we are using the electron as a source, and this is the final image. So this is the machine which is there, which we are using as electron microscope, and the results will be there in the computer only. So transmission and scanning electron microscope, TEM, the images are formed by transmitted electrons. It provides you the internal details of the specimen. And SEM, here rather than transmitted electrons, backscattered electrons are used, or the electrons which are bounced back for image formation. SEM provides you the surface details. So SEM provides you the surface detail, and TEM provides you the internal details of the specimen. The internal detail of the specimen is provided by the transmission, and surface details are provided with the SEM only. So this is again the diagrams. So these are all, this is the how we have to prepare the sample, how to use contrast and everything. And this is again the the preparation, how to prepare the sample for run it in a TEM, because the samples have to be prepared, cleaning the surface of the specimen. Then we have some fixative which also which we have to use, rinsing of the specimen, dehydrating the specimen. All these things are there in TEM when we have to put the samples. Sectioning and staining of the specimen is there, so you can read it by your own self also. Then we have SEM again. In the SEM we have illumination system, specimen stage, imaging system, image observation is there in case of SEM. So in case of SEM, when the specimen, when the electrons, they are just allowing to pass through the specimen, they will bounce back. That is all in case of microscopy. Are you able to get it or not? Please let me know, any one of you, are you able to get it or not? And are you able to understand the slave homework also? You have to tell me everything, the characteristic features of the light microscope, the four light microscopes and two electron microscope, number one. Now the number two is you have to tell me the difference between SEM and TEM. Number three, you have to draw the diagrams of SEM and TEM. So that is only for the part which is there in the microscopy. So is it clear to all of you? Please let me know. We have one more topic which is of bioinformatics, very small topic. So are you comfortable? Shall we proceed now? Please let me know.
So are you able to listen to me? My voice is audible, please let me know. Are you able to understand microscopy? And are you asking the third question is that we have to draw the diagrams of SEM and TEM, that is the electron microscope, scanning electron microscope as well as transmission electron microscope. You have to draw the diagrams of both two. So if it's clear to you, please let me know, anyone of you, please write down this presentation somewhere on a paper, but a homework from you, and then you'll have to post this paper also. And if I'm not sure, please write it somewhere if possible. Can you continue now? Please let me know. Can you continue now with bioinformatics part? This is the last topic, so can you continue now? shall we continue now? Please let me know. Shall we continue now? Please let me know my voice is audible to you. Shall we continue now?
Yes, now my voice is audible to all of you. Are you able to listen to me properly now? My voice is audible. Please let me know microbial. Please let me know Kushika also. So my voice is audible to you now. Please let me know. You are able to listen to me or not? Yes. So shall I have to repeat the questions again or are you able to get it properly? Shall I have to repeat the question again? Please let me know. May I have to repeat the questions again or you get it properly? Ankita, let me know. Have you able to understand the questions? Please let me know. Any one of you have understand the questions? Please let me know. Asim, you are able to understand the questions or may I have to repeat it again also? Please let me know. May I have to repeat it again? Asim, please let me know. May I have to repeat the questions again or are you getting it properly? Are you getting it properly or may I have to repeat it again? Okay, the questions are that you have to tell me the types of microscopy, the four types of light microscopy, two types of electron microscopy, along with their characteristic features, along with the important points which are there in that microscopy, number one. Then number two is you have to tell me the difference between SEM and TEM. That means scanning electron microscope and the transmission electron microscope. Number two question is this. Number three is you have to draw the diagrams. You have to make the diagrams of scanning electron microscope as well as transmission electron microscope. So these are the only three questions from the microscopy part. Yes, I am repeating. The number one is you have to let me know about the light microscopes, the four types of light microscope, which is dark field, bright field, phase contrast and fluorescence. And you have to tell me about two electron microscope, which is SEM and TEM. The important features, the important characteristics of those particular microscopes, the resolution, the magnification, everything. And number two, you have to tell me the difference between SEM and TEM, that is scanning and another transmission electron microscope. And then number three is you have to make the diagrams of all these. Yes. Okay, thank God it's clear to all of you. Actually today I am not feeling much well, that is why my volume is little bit low. I try to keep my volume high, but again I become slow again. Sorry for it, but I hope you will get it now. So that means you are not able to listen to the the microscopic topic then, because if my voice is low then maybe you are not able to get it properly. Asim, did you get it properly or not? The microscopic, the PPT of microscope. Yes. So did you get the presentation or not? Please let me know. Did you get the presentation? Are you able to understand the microscopy or not? This is the main thing. Are you able to get it or not? Please let me know. Okay, so thank you all for your cooperation. Now we have the last topic, which is bioinformatics. Any one of you aware of bioinformatics? Please let me know. Have you listened about bioinformatics before also? Please let me know. Okay, any one of you, are you aware of what is bioinformatics? Please let me know. Have you done any type of softwares which are there in the bioinformatics? Any one of you, have you done any softwares which are there in the bioinformatics? Please let me know. The softwares which are there in the bioinformatics, have you done it before also? Please let me know. Yeah, so on which software have you worked before? Have you done work on any software? Have you aware of some softwares which are there in the bioinformatics? Please let me know. Are you aware of these softwares or not? Okay, so Asim has done cluster W. Okay, Asim, so you have done cluster. Good, very good. Anyone else who has done some type of this phylogenetic work? Okay, please, I want the reply from all of you. Please let me know. I think I have to start. You are not replying to me. My voice is audible, Asim. My voice is audible. Please let me know. Then I will start the remaining part. My voice is audible to you, to all of you. We have Suchita here. We have Kasturi here. Please let me know. My voice is audible or not? Hello. Okay, thank you. So yes, today now we have to cover the another topic which is there, which is bioinformatics, the application and challenges of bioinformatics. So bioinformatics was invented by Hoffman and Hesper in 1970 as the study of informatic processes in the biotic system. So bioinformatics is the use of information and technology for data storage, data warehousing, and analyzing the DNA sequencing. So basically in bioinformatics, basically what we have, it is the use of information technology for data storage. We have to store the data, data warehousing, and even for analyzing the DNA sequences. When you have to work on the DNA sequences, when you want to specifically work on the DNA sequences, then there is a bioinformatics. So bioinformatics is a use of informational technology for the data storage, data warehousing, and analyzing the DNA sequences. So in bioinformatics, knowledge of many branches are required, like biology, mathematics, computer science, laws of physics and chemistry, and of course sound knowledge of information technology to analyze the biotech data. So bioinformatics is a mixed field. Basically, bioinformatics is a mixed field. In it we have biology, we have mathematics, we have computer science, we have laws of physics, chemistry. Everything is there in the bioinformatics. So bioinformatics is the branch, is the science, is the information technology in which we can store the data, data warehousing, and also we can analyze the DNA sequences. So given new DNA or the protein sequence, biologists will want to search databases of known sequences to look for anything similar. Sequence similarity can provide clues about function and evolutionary relationships. Databases such as GenBank, so we have GenBank also, are far too long to search manually, but to search them efficiently we need an algorithm, because we should not expect exact matches. So we have these challenges which are there in case of bioinformatics. So bioinformatics intends to find new approaches to deal with the volume and complexity of data, providing researchers with better access to analyze and computing tools in order to advance understanding of our genetic legacy and its role in health and genetic diseases, basically. Okay, so this is the bioinformatics. So there are many urgent open problems with lots of opportunities to make fundamental contribution to the society, develop our creativity and problem-solving skills to the limit, join a cross-disciplinary team and work with interesting people, participate in unlocking the mysteries of life itself so as to make the world a better place to live. So this is bioinformatics. It is a mixture of biology, of chemistry, of computer science, stats, everything is there. So bioinformatics is a that branch which consists of all branches of science, basically. So why bioinformatics is needed? The need for bioinformatics has arisen from the recent explosion of publicly available genomic information, such as resulting from Human Genome Project. So basically bioinformatics is needed to give a better understanding of gene analysis, taxonomy and evolution, to work efficiently on the rational drug designs and reduce the time taken for the development of the drug manually. So basically for drug designing, for drug purposes, to cure any type of genetic disease, to understand gene analysis, to understand Human Genome Project, all these we need a bioinformatics. So these are the goals of bioinformatics: to uncover the wealth of biological information hidden in the mass of sequence, structure, literature and biological data. So we have to uncover the wealth of biological information, the biological information which we all have. We have to understand all those biological information. For that we need a bioinformatics. It is being used now and in the foreseeable future in the areas of molecular medicine. It has environmental benefits in identifying waste and clean up the bacteria. In agriculture, it can be used to produce high yield, low maintenance crops. For that purpose also, to get high yield, low maintenance crops, we are using the bioinformatics. So, goal of bioinformatics is basically what? To uncover the wealth of biological information hidden in the mass of sequence, structure, literature and biological data. It is being used now and in the foreseeable future in the areas of molecular medicine. It has environmental benefits in identifying the waste and cleaning up the bacteria. In agriculture, it can be used. It can be used to produce high yield, low maintenance crops. After it, we have fields in which bioinformatics is quite useful. So it is useful in the field of molecular medicine, in the field of gene therapy, drug development, microbial genome applications, crop improvement, forensic analysis of microbes, biotechnology, evolutionary studies. So in all these fields, bioinformatics is quite useful. So where bioinformatics helps? So it helps in experimental molecular biology, in genetics and genomics, in generating biological data. It is helpful in the analysis of gene and protein expression. It is helpful in the comparison of genomic data, understanding of evolutionary aspects of evolution, understanding the biological pathways and networks in system biology, in simulation and modeling of DNA, RNA and protein. So in all these fields, bioinformatics is quite helpful. So it is helpful in the field of molecular biology, in the field of genetics, in the field of genomics, in biological data, in expression of a gene, in expression of proteins, in the modeling of DNA, RNA and proteins, even in the field of evolutionary aspects, in the field of evolutionary pathways, bioinformatics is quite needed. So this is the bioinformatics. It can be either used as sequence analysis, or even we can work on the structural bioinformatics also. So this is the bioinformatics. We can use it as a sequence analysis as well as structural bioinformatics. So what is structural bioinformatics? When we have the prediction of structure from a sequence, we have scanned the structure, homology modeling, threading, analysis of the 3D structure. For all these purposes, we need the bioinformatics. So this is when we want to work on the nucleotide sequence, at that time also we need bioinformatics. When we want to work on the structure of the proteins or any other biomolecule, at that time we also need the bioinformatics. So these are the some things which are there in case of bioinformatics. Let me clear you one thing. Bioinformatics is a very vast field, okay? I have taken 10 days long lecture series for 2 hours specifically on this bioinformatics part only. So it will not be justice to bioinformatics to complete it in a 1 hour session. So if you want to understand bioinformatics in detail, you can go through my previous videos also, which are specifically on the bioinformatics part. But in this lecture series, I just try to touch bioinformatics, as my main motive is to tell you about the basics only. So I just touch the parts which are there in the bioinformatics. Otherwise, 10-day lecture series is also available on my channel. You can go and you can just click on the link and you can listen and watch the videos. So this is why we have to align the sequences. One could align the sequence so that many corresponding residues match. Strong similarity between two sequences is a strong argument for their homology. Now we have homology. What is homology? When two or more sequences have a common ancestor. Two or more sequences have a common ancestor. This is known as homology. Then we have similarity. Now what is similarity? Two or more sequences are similar by some criteria and it does not refer to any historical process. This is known as a similarity. So we have basis of sequence alignment. Basically, what is alignment? What is sequence? To find the relativeness of the proteins or gene if they have a common ancestor, for that we have to align the sequences. So we have to align the sequences. Mutation in the sequences bring the changes, can also reveal the part of sequence which is crucial for the functioning of a gene or a protein. So these are some terms which are there in this bioinformatics. In the sequence alignment, we have optical alignment, we have global alignment, we have local alignment. These are the terms which are there. Gaps and insertions are there. Gap finality is there. All these are the terms which are there in the this sequence alignment. Sequence alignment is basically when you have to compare your sequences. So if you are able to see, this is one sequence and this is another sequence. So we have A, C, G, T, C, T, G, A, T, A, C, G. So if you are able to compare, if you are able to do the alignment of this sequence, you will see 18 sequences they are matching. So C here, C here, T here, T here. Two mismatches are there. Here T, but instead of A, here we have A. So instead of A here, we have T here. Similarly, we have A here, but instead of A, we have C here. So there are two mismatches and gaps are 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So we have 7 gaps. So this is how we have to store the sequence alignment basically. Similarly, this is again, we have two mismatches. We have gaps here. So this is how you have to do the sequence alignment. And for the sequence alignment, we have two methods. We have FASTA sequences and we have BLAST also. Let me show you that thing. So yes, we have FASTA sequence, which is a multi-step approach to find high scoring alignments, exact short word matches, maximum scoring and gapped extensions, identify gapped alignments also. So this is the FASTA sequences. Then we have BLAST sequences also. I will show you on the net also. This is, we have BLAST 10 when we are working on the nucleotide sequences, BLAST P when we are working on the protein sequences. So we have different types of data sources also available, where we have the storage of data. Like we have GenBank, we have DDBJ, which is there in Japan. So these are the data banks in which the data is stored. So you can approach and you can able to download the data from that particular sources. Like we have GenBank, we have EMBL, we have data DNA data bank of Japan also. So from it you will able to download the sequences also. Now again, this that the bioinformatics is useful in studying the nucleotides, amino acids, protein domains, protein structure. We are able to understand gene therapy. We are able it for doing it for drug development, for doing for the disease, for genetic information, for gene identification, for climate change studies. For everything we are able to use the bioinformatics part. These are some another applications of this bioinformatics. That is all. So it is more than just a genome. Over 300 publicly available databases pertaining to molecular biology. We have GenBank, we have protein data bank, we have SwissProt. All these are here, there for the storage of the sequences. Like we have NIG, we have EBI, we have NCBI, which is known as National Center for Biological Information. EBI is the European Bioinformatics Institute. NIG is the National Institute of Genetics. So all these are for basically for the storage of the data. And these are the applications that the bioinformatics is helpful in the sequence analysis, in the prediction of protein structure, genome annotation. So all these are there also for the health and drug discovery. All these things are there in case of the bioinformatics. So this is again the summary of bioinformatics, that we are able to study these all sequences which are here. So in case of bioinformatics, we will able to do next generation sequencing. We will able to do sequence alignment analysis and interpretation, gene finding, genome mapping, protein structure alignment and prediction. Even we can use it for prediction of gene expression, protein-protein interactions, evolution modeling, drug discovery, and even in pharmaceutical industries we can use the bioinformatics. So bioinformatics is the acquisition application of computational tools storage, arrangement, identification, achieving analysis, interpretation, visualization, all these things are there. Communication approaches for expanding the use of biological, medical, behavior or health data in the molecular biology. So this term was introduced as any application of computation in the field of biology, including data management, algorithm development and data mining. So this is bioinformatics. It is the application of information technology to the field of molecular biology. So these are the some common activities of bioinformatics. We are able to do, and we are able to mapping and analyzing the DNA, RNA, protein, amino acids, lipids. We are able to do sequence alignment analysis. We are able to visualize 3D structures for everything. We need this bioinformatics, sequence alignment, annotation, gene finding, genome mapping, protein structure alignment, for gene expression, for evolution, for drug discovery, for biopharmaceuticals. For all these, we are needing this bioinformatics. So I will share this PDF with all of you, and you have to read it by your own self, because bioinformatics is a very vast field. It is not, it's not easy to complete it in a single 20 or 30 minutes lecture. It is a 10-day lecture series. So I will suggest to you to go on my previous videos, and then you will be able to understand bioinformatics in much detail. Even there is one software which is there in bioinformatics, which is known as Mega 606. I hope all of you, I don't know all of you, but maybe some of you will be able to know about this Mega software. So like some of you is saying, like Asim is saying about cluster. So there are some software which are present online. You have to put your sequences, and after using the cluster, you are able to align those particular sequences. Getting my point? So you will be able to align those particular sequences. Are you getting my point? So this is all in case of bioinformatics. We have many softwares which are there. We have Cluster W, we have muscle software, we have phylogenetic analysis software. Many things are there in case of bioinformatics. It is a 10-day long lecture series. Maybe in future we will also do another lecture series on this bioinformatics class. For it, you all are most welcome. You can come and you can watch those lecture series also. And I think that's all for my today's lecture series. I hope all of you will get something from these lecture series which we have together. And that's all from my side. This is our last day for our YouTube live session. And after tomorrow onwards, you have to focus on your review paper only. And I will reply to you either by Telegram or by the mail also. So I wish you all the best for your future perspectives also. I know you all are very intelligent and you are doing great in your life. Best wishes from my side also for your future journey. But this lecture series is over now. And if you want to say something, you are most welcome. If you want to say something, you are most welcome to show. New to bioinformatics, and even I didn't share anything in much detail regarding bioinformatics, so I will not give you any homework regarding bioinformatics, because I know this field is quite new to you. So it will be an injustice to all of you if I will give you some homework related to bioinformatics. Only you have to do the homework which is there is from the microscopic part only. If you have any another query, you can ask me, please. Guys, that is all from this lecture series which we have together. From tomorrow onwards, you all are free. I will share the PPTs, Ipsita, don't worry. And Sanhita, okay, we will do the Google Meet, but not today. Maybe tomorrow we will do the Google Meet. And on that only I will help you regarding the review paper, okay? So I know many of you have many queries regarding review paper. So we will try to interact with each other, but I will answer the queries related to review paper. So I think it will be fine for all of you. Sanhita, please let me know. Yes, I want to interact with all of you because the lecture series is over now, so only for review papers we will interact definitely. Because right now only 20 students are there and this is a lecture series of 200 students. So I don't know why the others are not here, why they are not joining with us, but it's okay, no worries. We will try to interact on Google Meet tomorrow. Related to review papers, if you all want that. Yes, I will share the PPT. Don't worry, why you are worrying regarding it. Please don't take any suggestions. I will share the PPT. Don't worry. And definitely we will interact with each other, don't worry, we will try to interact tomorrow on Google Meet. But it is my, Satvik or someone, you have to make the Google Meet thing. I will join only in the Google Meet thing, that's the thing I can do only. So any volunteer, he or she can make the link and I will join on the Google Meet link, not today, but tomorrow. And the timing will be, I think in the night will be, the timing will be okay. By 7 or 8, I think at that time you all are free. Like today in this afternoon session only 22 students are present. So we will try to meet on by 7 p.m. or by 8 p.m. It's that there is no classes now, you all are free now. You have to focus on the review paper now only. I have completed all the topics which are there in the lecture series. So now you have to focus on the review paper only. So I wish you all the best for your future and for your future goals and everything. Hope you all will shine in your future also. And please stay in touch with me also. So that's all for today. If you have anything to say, you can. Please let me know. Even if you are not able to get any topic, even if you are not able to understand anything, you are very free to ask me. You are very free. I will try my level best to help you all. So don't worry regarding anything. If anything is not, you can say if any of your topic or anything is not clear to you, you can ask me. Yes, I will share the PPT Sukriti. Don't worry, I will share with all of you. Please don't worry. Yes. So thank you all for your patience and for being here with me. Thank you all for your time, for your support. And hope we all will meet soon also. Maybe in the next lecture series. Till then, you have to take care of yourself. Work hard and achieve great in your life. That is the best wishes from my side only. Take care of yourself. You can go through my. Yes, Chapman, you can submit your review topic or abstract when you will be free, no worries. And if you are interested in bioinformatics, because I am not comfortable or I am not satisfied with my bioinformatics lecture today, I will suggest you to go to my previous lecture series. I have my 10 days lecture series on bioinformatics. If you are interested in bioinformatics, you can watch my previous lecture series. You will definitely get a very good knowledge regarding the bioinformatics. In those classes, I have discussed phylogenetic software, which are there. I have discussed mega software. Drug designing is there. And even there are some interesting topics which are there related to bioinformatics. So you can watch my previous videos also. Because the PPT which I shared with you regarding the bioinformatics, it is not appropriate. It is only a basics only. But if you are quite interested in bioinformatics, then you can watch my previous lecture series. Okay, so for that, even you can subscribe my channel also, so that when I will be online related to any another topic, you all will be there. You will get the notification. And you all are welcome, you all are my students, you all are welcome to be there along with me in my next lecture series also. Like I am running bioinformatics part also, biochemistry is there, genetics is also there, so you can join those sessions also. Yes, so take care of yourself and goodbye. We will meet on Google Meet for review paper discussion only, so that I will let you know everything related to review paper. If you have any doubts regarding the review paper, then we will discuss it tomorrow. But otherwise, the lecture series are over here. We are completed our homework. We are completed the topics which are there in the MBBT lecture series. We will meet tomorrow on Google Meet only for to interact with all of you and to discuss something related to review paper. So that's all from my side with lots of best wishes. I'm just saying you goodbye and take care of yourself. Yes, Swapnil, Lasim, Harshini, Ishita, Sruti. All of you, please take care of yourself. Nikita, Sanket, Vartika, please take care of yourself and achieve great heights in your life. Achieve good in your life. So right now you have 248 members in your class, but only 20 students are present today. So it's okay, but try to complete your assignment. Okay, so goodbye, bye bye from my side, and please complete your assignment and send it to me on time. Okay, try to complete your assignment and send it to me on time. So that's all from my side. Bye bye to all. Bye bye. Take care.